It's time for questions and ministers' statements. And can I please call Dr. Bark with a question?
Thank you, President. I have another question today for the Minister for Corrections. Minister, the paper from the Justice and Reform Initiative released yesterday, The State of Incarceration Insights into Imprisonment in Victoria, noted that in 2022, last year, $1 billion of Victorians' taxpayers' money was spent on operating the state's prisons, which, the initiative noted, is a 96% increase from what was spent in 2012-13, despite far fewer people occupying prison beds and a reduction in available programs. Are the details quoted by the Justice Reform Initiative right? And if not, how are they wrong?
Minister.
Thank you, Dr. Bark, and I thank him for his interest in relation to the criminal justice system and in particular our correction system. I mean, we've already said as a government that our focus is on keeping Victorians safe and giving people the best opportunity to turn their lives around whilst they're in our custody and care. And as I visited a lot of Middleton on Monday, we're focused on giving them the best chance to rehabilitate through initiating programs that give them the skills and training needed to, upon their release, to reintegrate into society as best as possible. That's for employment pathways, that's for housing options, and it's for provide mental health and other health services, because we know that people in our care usually have more complex needs. In terms of the question about our investments in our correction system, I make no apologies about investing great amounts of money into our corrections and justice system, because that's what we do as a government. We do what matters. People want us to invest in better outcomes, and as you would know, the number of people incarcerated in our state has decreased over the last 3 years, and I think that is as a result, that is the dividends of our investments. Thank you.
Dr. Bark with a supplementary.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister very much for his fascinating answer. In addition, by way of supplementary, Minister, the report also noted a lack of culturally suitable services available to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, who comprise 12% of the state's adult prison population, which again has doubled in the last 10 years. What specific programs are available to that cohort in Victoria's prison system?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Bark. Victoria has the second lowest rate of incarceration for Indigenous people. So I'll just start off that factual matter. I'll dispose of that. But in terms of the supports, in terms of providing support to our First Nations people, we have culturally appropriate spaces. We have specific health checks targeted to our Aboriginal population. We have an Aboriginal Women's Healing Unit. So there are a number of programs as well that's in the adult system and in the youth justice system, and there are many more I could talk about. But I think the premise is that we acknowledge that our First Nations people are disproportionately affected and represented in our criminal justice system. That is something that we are looking at as a government and we take very seriously. And I think there is a number of reforms that are being proposed or will come to this chamber in due course. And I want to thank our Attorney General, Jacqueline Symes, for her work.
Thank you, Minister. Time's expired. Mr. Edichang, with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister Blanthorn, representing the Minister for Health. As highlighted in my adjournment speech last night, the cost of medicinal cannabis, up to $1,000 per week for some patients, can be a hugely prohibitive barrier to access, particularly for those who are unable to work as a result of their severe illness. Put simply, medicinal cannabis legislation does not equate to access for thousands of patients. To this end, the Australian Medicinal Cannabis Association is seeking to establish Compass, a charitably funded compassionate access scheme that will provide subsidised access for certain medicinal cannabis patients in Australia, and has sought seed funding, if you'll pardon the pun, from the federal government. So the question I ask is, will the minister lobby her federal counterpart, Minister Butler, to support the AMCA proposal? Thank you.
Mr. Edichang, for your question and for your care and concern for people who are suffering, it's obviously a question for the Minister for Health, as you identified, and in accordance with the standing orders, I will pass that on to her and ensure that you receive a response.
Before I call Mr. Edishank, I'm happy to take your supplementary. I kind of feel like that was more of an adjournment matter than a question, but I will take your supplementary. Thanks.
I thank the Minister for her response. By way of supplementary, I simply ask, will the Minister meet with Lucy Haslam, the co-founder and chair of the Australian Medical Cannabis Association and Compass, in the same context?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you again, Ms. Edishank. And again, I will pass that on to the Minister for Health for her consideration.
Minister's statement from Minister Erdogan.
I rise to update the House on last week's launch of Victoria's first victims legal service, the result of a $7.3 million investment by the Andrews Labor government. The victims legal service provides free legal advice and support to people who have suffered injury or loss as a result of a crime. It can help them seek compensation from the person who committed the crime, the offender, but the service can also help victims of crime seek financial assistance through the existing Victims of Crime Assistance Tribunal. I want to thank Victoria Legal Aid, as well as community legal centres and Aboriginal legal service providers across the state. They are partnering with the government to deliver this vital service. The Victims Legal Service was co-designed in close partnership with legal stakeholders, including Aboriginal legal services and people that specialise in working with women experiencing family violence. We also consulted closely with the Victims of Crime Consultative Committee to ensure the service best meets the needs of victims of crime. In just its first week of operation, the Victims Legal Service assisted 45 victims with information and legal advice. It also made 18 referrals to supporting providers for ongoing legal work. People can contact the Victims Legal Service helpline on 1800 531 566. This is just one of the many ways of ensuring that the voices of victims of crime are front and centre in our criminal justice system. The government has invested close to $100 million to deliver on its commitment to establish a new financial assistance scheme, a landmark reform for victims of crime in Victoria. Once the financial assistance scheme is operational, the Victims Legal Service will continue to be there to support victims with legal advice and information.
Mr. Davis.
President, my question is to the Attorney-General. In the last financial year, the Andrews Labor government increased the number of challenges to Information Commissioner Freedom of Information rulings from 16 to 30, an 87% increase. Why has the Andrews Labor government so sharply increased the number of rulings by the number of challenges to rulings by the Information Commissioner, who is the independent umpire?
Minister?
Thank you, President. I think Mr. Davis brings a question. But I don't dictate the legal decisions of individual departments or offices. That would be incredibly inappropriate. So in terms of any decisions to exercise people's legal right, whether they be an individual or a government department, is a matter for them, and in very many instances, more than appropriate to challenge decisions that they want to get tested. 16 to 30.
Mr. Davis?
Minister, the 61 challenges to the umpire OVIC's rulings by the government since the 1st of July 2020 are a clear sign that the government is determined to keep its secrets secret. How is this model litigant behaviour?
Order. Before I call. The Minister, I couldn't hear Mr. Davis' question, so could you ask him? No, I couldn't. Just not the secret bit, the question.
How is this model litigant behaviour?
Minister.
President, thank Mr. Davis for his supplementary question, and I don't agree that it's a clear sign of the way you've articulated it at all. I do not receive information, no one seeks advice from me about whether to challenge a matter under the FOI laws, but there are many reasons that one may seek to challenge FOI that is in the interests of protecting personal information, commercial in confidence. There are a number of reasons that it would be appropriate to have these matters tested by an independent umpire, and that independent umpire ain't me.
Ms. Copsey with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Environment. The Nature Fund was established by the Andrews government to fund high-impact projects to stop the decline of Victoria's native plants and animals. It was given $10 million in last year's budget, but that money has now been allocated, applications are closed, and there is currently no commitment to any further funding. Will the government commit money to extend the Nature Fund in the upcoming budget?
Minister.
I thank Ms. Copsey for her question and her interest in these matters, and can I say that I've had the pleasure of recently meeting with the chair and the CEO for the Trust for Nature, and they do amazing work in our state. They have been overseeing a really wonderful program of creating covenants to protect private land for many, many years now. And of course, this is a key part of our biodiversity 2037 strategy to increase the amount of public and private land that is rehabilitated, revegetated, so that we can, within the environment space, play our part in driving down emission reduction targets. We've got very ambitious targets in Victoria, and it's really going to take a whole of government effort, including in the environment portfolio, to drive those targets down. So in relation to your specific question about funding for the Trust for Nature, you know, I'm not in a position to preempt what the deliberations of the budget may result in. That is a matter that, you know, has quite a process behind it, and of course the Treasurer will at the appropriate time make those announcements associated with the budget, including for the environment portfolio. But what I can reassure you of is that the Andrews Labor government is absolutely committed to supporting all of our various environment initiatives, and in particular organisations like the Trust for Nature, in the very important work that they do in getting very good environmental outcomes in our state.
Ms. Copsey with a supplementary.
Thank you, President. Thank you to the Minister for that answer. And to I wish you well in those deliberations. And to put some context around those, the New South Wales government has an equivalent fund that gives out roughly $75 million per year. Other states have funds that are similar and give away much more than $10 million a year. It's really a drop in the ocean when it comes to the extent of the biodiversity crisis that we're facing in Victoria right now. Will the government commit in the upcoming budget to scale up the investment in the Nature Fund to meet the size of the biodiversity crisis in our state?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Copsey for her supplementary question, and can I say that I'm smarting a little bit at the comparison with New South Wales because since coming to government in 2014, we have invested over $560 million in Victoria on biodiversity initiatives, and that is the single largest investment of a Victorian government ever. And we're absolutely committed to our ambitious plans that are contained within the Biodiversity 2037 strategy. And as Environment Minister, I'm going to, you've thrown down the gauntlet now by raising New South Wales, and I'm absolutely committed to ensuring that we continue to build on that record into the future.
Minister Blandthorne with a minister statement, please.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on how the Andrews Labor government is supporting the recruitment of new child protection practitioners to support Victorian families. Child protection practitioners play a key role in keeping Victorian children safe, and it's this side of the House that back this workforce and the important work that they do. Since 2014, we've been proud to have funded an additional 1,180 child protection practitioners to ensure that we keep Victorian children as safe as we can. It's important to contrast this when those opposite were in power, and Dr. Bark was a key advisor to a former minister, and they cut 500 staff from the Department of Human Services. In case you couldn't hear me, Dr. Bark, 500 staff from the Department of Human Services. It's not only funding additional child protection practitioners where there's a difference in approach. We've increased funding in family services to over $385 million. That's a threefold increase in funding compared to those opposite. President, we recognise the need to promote the fulfilling career option that child protection offers Victorian job seekers. And that's why last week we launched the latest round of our Go Where You're Needed campaign. Through the campaign, we continue to attract a highly skilled, capable and diverse child protection workforce for metropolitan, regional and rural areas. The campaign is a key part of the government's work to attract and retain skilled staff to this sector. Supporting families is important and impactful, and in helping to create better futures for Victorian children and their families. A key element of the campaign is showcasing the positive difference people working for Victoria's Child Protection Service make each and every day by protecting children at risk and keeping families strong. Child protection practitioners gain a wide range of professional skills and are specialists in working with families who are most at risk. They can choose their own career path and collaborate with other professionals to support families. The campaign is running through metropolitan and regional radio, regional press and social media, including Facebook, Instagram and LinkedIn. We're proud to be promoting the work of child protection practitioners, not talking them down or cutting their workforce like those opposite.
Sorry, Minister, there are child protection jobs that... Minister, time's expired. Ms Barth with a question, please.
Thank you, President. President, my question is to the Minister for Environment. The Inverloch Surf Life Saving Club is under considerable threat from coastal erosion due to the degradation of the sand dunes on the surf beach. The Cape to Cape Resilience Project proposes major capital works including breakwaters, groins, rock walls, renourishment to arrest this destructive environment through erosion. Minister, when will your government act to stop the Inverloch Surf Life Saving Club being washed away?
Minister.
President, I jumped the gun then. Thank you, Ms Barth, for your question. And of course, this is a key issue, coastal erosion and sea rise, the combined effects of tides and storm activity and coastal processes and local conditions are something that present real challenges to communities right along the Victorian coastline. And of course, Inverloch is an example of where that is seen at its most sort of stark. It's why we've allocated $16.9 million in our last budget towards various initiatives to tackle coastal erosion. And it's all contained in our marine and coastal strategy, which is available, a publicly available strategy on the DECA website. It's incredibly important that we do work closely with communities along the coastline, and Inverloch is an important example of that. It's where DECA is leading the first regional and strategic partnership, or the RASP, under the Marine and Coastal Act, and it comprises nine agencies and it also involves the Bunurong Land Council Aboriginal Corporation, and there's been extensive work done to consult the community about what some of the mitigation strategies might best suit the situation in Inverloch. So we've invested more than $1.5 million down there installing coastal protection structures on the Inverloch surf beach to protect the public infrastructure, including the surf club that you've raised. And we've invested an additional $850,000 in the RASP to fund that technical assessment that's going to be required to go to stage two of that program. So I hope that gives you a little bit of a feel for what we're doing down at Inverloch.
Ms Barth with the supplementary.
Thank you, President. I thank the Minister for her response. Now, and I take up her points about consultation, but to quote the Inverloch Surf Life Saving Club's environmental officer, Warren Cook, and former member of the Cape to Cape Resilience Project stakeholder group, who resigned in frustration due to inaction, Mr Cook says, and I quote, consultation is good, but at the end, but it has been going on for 3 years now. It's time for action. Minister, after 3 years of consultation, when will the funding be made available to implement the Cape to Cape Resilience Plan as a matter of urgency to save this life-saving club?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And I do take issue with the way that you're presenting that supplementary question, because I've just taken you through the investment that we've already made in stage one of that project. Stage two is now underway, and there's an additional contribution of $3.3 million. And I know that my colleagues who represent Eastern Victoria are very pleased with the work that's going on down there. And the federal government has also contributed $400,000 to undertake that important work, and the consultation with the community will continue. And we're proud that we're actually able to work so closely with the community on these challenges.
Order. Order. Mrs. Tyrrell has a question.
Can you explain why the grassroots football clubs who are attached to the leagues that aren't affiliated with the AFL are unable to access the same government grants as those who are? Some of these clubs serve as community centres and emergency evacuation hubs are in desperate need of facility upgrades. These individual clubs don't have the option to affiliate themselves with the AFL if their affiliated leagues choose not to.
Minister?
For that question, for the record, I'm not known for my prowess on the AFL or indeed the basic principles that underpin that particular code. I do understand, however, that it is a very, very popular leisure time activity, and my process when watching any of these sorts of things is that I really just hope that both teams get out there and have a lot of fun. So I'm not ideally placed to answer that question on behalf of Mr. Demopoulos, but what I will do, given his comparative expertise in the area, is seek an answer for you from him in accordance with the standing orders.
Ms. Tyrrell, supplementary?
No.
Minister Tini with a minister's statement.
President, I'm pleased to update the chamber on Victorian universities leading the world in expanding to new frontiers. This month, our own Deakin University Vice-Chancellor, Professor Ian Martin, and the Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese, officially announced the establishment of the GIFT campus in India. This is the first university in the world to open an international teaching campus in India. Deakin has had a presence in India since 1994, and this has facilitated strong collaboration on research, education, and training. Set to open in 2024, the same year Deakin celebrates its 50th anniversary and 30 years in India, the international campus will deliver job-ready graduates to meet India's soaring skills and labour demands and bolster Deakin's commitment to providing a world-class education and learning experience for students around the globe. Professor Martin said Deakin's approach was, quote, in India, with India, for India, and end of quote, and that as the university prepared to celebrate its 50th anniversary in 2024, opening a new India campus marked an exciting chapter for the university. Deakin Vice President Global Alliances and CEO Asia, Ms. Power, said that the momentous occasion for Australia and India could not be surpassed. The new campus aims to provide a world-class postgraduate education to meet industry-skilled workforce demands within the country. The India campus will provide better opportunities for local students who cannot afford to travel and live in Australia to study. I congratulate Deakin University on this world-first achievement and look forward to hearing about the many achievements of Indian Deakin graduates.
Yeah. Mrs. MacArthur with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Regional Development. Exciting. Minister, compulsory acquisition powers legalise state confiscation of private assets and as such should only be a last resort where no alternative is available and there is an overwhelming public interest argument. I hope we can all agree on that. hopefully. Yet opposite the 12 apostles, your department plans the hostile and forcible acquisition of 32 hectares of land from the Nestler family. No. Despite their willingness to invest private money and develop the site they have legally owned for more than 50 years. In October 2019, your predecessor, Minister Symes, promised the family cooperation on the development and stated no compulsory acquisition would occur. What has changed now to justify this confiscation?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Firstly, thank you, Mrs. MacArthur, for identifying the importance of regional development to this chamber. I'm grateful to you for that question. I want to perhaps correct a couple of the things that have been presupposed in your question around the history of this matter and of engagement with the Nestler family and the broader community. Within the 12 Apostles precinct development process, we're actually really proud to be supporting this initiative that once it's complete will transform the visitor experience of the iconic part of the state that really is, it's world famous, it's extraordinary, but it's also important that we add the necessary level of amenity. So that streamlined connection to the local attractions is really, really important, and that's where, again, the cultural and environmental context for this is also a key part of this work, as you would be aware, and as indeed the community is aware. This is also something which Minister Stitt is very closely involved with to make sure that we are actually delivering this project in partnership with the Commonwealth to the standard necessary to reflect the ongoing priorities of the community now and indeed into the future. As you've flagged, the development does include an international visitor experience centre alongside that infrastructure and those amenities, and we do want to make sure, as I said, that shipwreck coast visitation numbers continue to go up over the years to come, and that we build that in with my other portfolio hat of Commonwealth Games to the experiences that Victoria 2026 will deliver. There have been numerous conversations, not just with the Nestler family, but also with the community. You're right to identify Minister Symes' ongoing interest in this matter, but it's also really important to note that there have been conversations and discussions with representatives from Regional Development Victoria and the Nestler family that have been going on for some time. I really want to make it clear that discussions are continuing with the family and that the community overwhelmingly does back this project going ahead in the terms that we've outlined. It's also really important to note that the partnerships that we have with the Commonwealth, whereby under the city deal we will contribute $292 million and the Commonwealth will contribute $183.8 million with other delivery partners and the city of Geelong, Greater Geelong, contributing more than $26 million. This isn't something that is being done in a haphazard or laissez-faire way. We are working through the process and those conversations with the Nestler family go on.
Mrs. MacArthur, supplementary.
Thank you, President. And I thank the Minister for her attempt to answer the question. But, Minister, the Nestlers over a very long period of time have shown their willingness and ability to develop this site without any requirement for state or federal taxpayer investment. And to forcibly acquire this family's land simply because the government prefers different owners is beyond disgraceful. It is state-sanctioned theft. Your letter to the Nestlers further stated that you will exempt the scheme from the requirement for prior reservation, a process which allows public participation and consultation with the affected landowners. Such exemption is envisaged for minor acquisitions with little material impact or for cases of particular urgency. This is a vast and long-term project. Why are you removing another safeguard of the private property rights which defines civilised society?
Minister.
Thank you, Mrs. MacArthur. I don't think that this does, in fact, constitute the definition of civilised society, as you've just put it to the Chamber. What I would, however, say, though, is that there are processes in place to do projects in a way which deliver environmental, cultural, visitation and economic benefit to our regions. That's why this particular set of projects under the deal are so germane to the idea of doing things properly and in an integrated fashion, so that, as I said, we've got benefit to the region for years to come. This is, and I'll go back to the point that I made in answer to the substantive question, a matter that's continuing to be part of discussions with the Nestler family. There are various conversations happening, not just with RDV, but also within the planning framework and discussions about that system and the way in which it might impact upon delivery of the project. But overwhelmingly, it's important to note that we are so committed to doing this project properly and to doing the right thing by everybody who enjoys and indeed relies upon the Shipwreck Coast for all of the benefits that it delivers.
Mr. Limbrugger, the question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Equality. The Minister would know that I have a strong interest in the defence of the rights of Victorians, and indeed it's been one of my main sources of disagreement with the government over the last few years. But my question to the Minister is this. Do the rights of biological women and transgender women sometimes come into conflict?
No, I was just concerned, Mr. Limbrugger, you're asking for an opinion. Like, if you'd like to change the terminology, please.
Thank you, President. The Minister gave a Minister's statement on Tuesday on the issue of transgender women's rights. So, okay, let me rephrase the question then. What is the Minister doing to find solutions for potential conflicts between biological women and transgender women? Thank you.
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Limbrick, for that question. And I do note your position and your very well articulated and well understood position on these matters. I have talked at length about the importance of making sure that vulnerable cohorts of Victorians are given the respect and the support and the visibility that they deserve and which we all should ideally enjoy. There has for a long time been a tension, not of the creation of the trans and gender diverse communities, but of others, to seek to create a divide between people who are from our LGBTIQ plus communities and people who are not. And it's a really dangerous distinction, to my mind, to be drawing, not just because what it does do is perhaps permit or encourage the stigma that we as LGBTIQ plus people live with, but also to seek to excuse conversations in the name of civilised debate or different views that are at their heart about saying that one particular group within our communities should have lesser rights to participate in a range of activities that we all take for granted. For example, being able to apply for a job and actually get it without your gender or gender identity or sexuality being part of a decision not to employ you. Being able to retain your job. Being able to participate in sport, being able to access healthcare, being able to access documentation that reflects your identity and is therefore necessary for international travel and for the dignity of participating in the decision making on everything from filling out forms to the way that you open your wallet and see yourself reflected in the various cards that that you carry with you. It's so important that we understand that in these conversations, the disadvantage and the stigma that is not just caused but is perpetuated and augmented by a conversation on this conflict between rights ignores the overwhelming views of Australians and indeed of Victorians that trans people should have the same rights as others to participate in everyday life and be given the same opportunities and indeed protections at law to do that wherever it is a thing that is required to be done. Again, really importantly, I want to see that any conversations about trans rights are done in a way that actually recognises the damage that they cause and recognises the desire for trans people simply to be able to live in the same way as everybody else.
Ms. Limbick, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for her answer. It sounded to me from your answer, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, that you don't see that there is a conflict, because to my mind, it looks like there may be situations where there are conflicts where the government may need to look for solutions on how to manage and deal with those conflicts.
That was a statement, but I think the Minister's prepared to respond. Minister.
Thank you, President. The nature of conflict in this particular issue, to my mind, and indeed as articulated by this government and by a range of other people, not just in Victoria but around Australia and the world, is that this conflict arises because there are people and organisations and groups, none of which I will name here, who think that trans rights should be able to be compromised because others feel uncomfortable. That is a conflict, to my mind, that is a contrivance, that is in fact something that seeks to excuse an argument, to denigrate, to weaponise against and to cause or perpetuate discrimination or stigma in the name of the idea of robust debate, a difference of views. The conflict does not come from the trans community. The conflict comes because people view the trans community as somehow different in a way that should enable them to be treated differently.
Minister Stitt, the Minister's statement.
President, and further to the topic of biodiversity, and thanks to $500,000 investment from the Andrews Labor government, the Hamilton Parklands predator-proof fence upgrade is now complete. The new barrier around Hamilton Sanctuary will better protect endangered and threatened animals, including the eastern barred bandicoot and the fat-tailed dunnart. Oh, I can't believe that. It's so cute. Google it. The fence includes a floppy top to prevent predators from entering the enclosure, and this extra protection allows for other endangered species to be released or temporarily housed in the area, and will encourage the recovery of the eastern barred bandicoot population numbers in the area. The first Australian species, over my friends to the right, the first Australian species to have its conservation status reclassified from extinct in the wild to endangered. Well, this is a significant investment from the Andrews Labor government in wildlife recovery following the 1920 bushfires, and forms part of the $62.2 million biodiversity response and recovery program. Hamilton Sanctuary will act as an emergency shelter location for animals affected by bushfires, giving them a secure home while they wait to be returned to their natural habitat when the risk subsides. The upgraded fence will keep these endangered and threatened animals safe from predators, encouraging their population growth. This is a critical step towards protecting and preserving our precious biodiversity, and it's a testament to the hard work and dedication of all of those who work tirelessly to make it happen. Thank you, President.
Thank you. That ends Minister's statements and questions.